Welcome to Programming with Qt Widgets. I've tucked away the rabbits, I've put the dog on silent mode, and I poured myself a fresh cup of coffee. Because in this episode, we're going to talk about a very difficult topic, layout management. You've already done a lot of layout management if you've been following along in this training, both by hand in C++ and done it in Qt Designer. It hopefully feels somewhat natural now, but there's still a lot of corner cases to cover. And that's what we'll be talking about in this episode. But let me start out showing an application where I could not use a layout manager, because in the end, it's not always that you want just things to be standing side by side or on top of each other or in a grid. Have a look at this application here. It seems almost like a usual application, but there's something that is slightly different, namely this button sitting here on top of this tab layout. First of all, why is it overlapping with a few pixels? And how do you even get a button to sit over there? Well, that's the whole idea with this example. The example comes from Qt Widgets and More, and there's a link here for that episode. The idea with this is that this is a burger menu, and I have an application with lots and lots of different windows in it, and I want this burger menu to be on top, in the rightmost, topmost corner of all of my widgets. And in that situation, it's simply not possible to put it into a layout. Imagine that I put it into a layout, just for the thought process here. The layout would be putting things next to each other, possibly if it was a horizontal layout. Well, then the tab widget would end on the left edge of my button, and all of the space underneath would be wasted. If I put it into a horizontal layout, then it would end on the bottom edge of the bottom, and all of that to the left here would be lost. But I actually put it up here. Not in a layout. What I did was that I made this button a child of the window here. So it would be laid out in the geometry of that topmost widget in here. And then I used something called event filter, we'll talk about much later, to make it possible for me. Of course, what you'll notice is that when I resize it here, it actually follows along. So I move the button every time the topmost widget is being resized. So that's an example where a layout manager would not work. And hey, I even got a slide for that. So you can see here on the slide, you can place your widgets and resize them using move and resize. And it looks like what you have down here. I'll simply create my top level window. I will resize that to a given position. Then I'll create my checkbox. I don't need to resize it to have the proper size, because its size hint will make sure that it get a proper size, I think. See, I never do stuff like this, but in any case, I can move it just like I did with the button. And there is this set geometry, which is really just a move and resize in one go. Nobody uses that anymore, but that's what we did in the 1990s in X11. Profiling is easy, right? You just find wherever your application is slow and you fix it. Or maybe it isn't that easy. Maybe you need to understand exactly how to apply the tool. Take a training from QTopia to learn exactly that. So let's just run really fast through what layout managers we have in Qt. We have four different layout managers. We have VBox layout, HBox layout, grid layout, and form layout. And let me show you each of those one after the other. So the HBox layout and the VBox layout, we can even show them together. It's just, remember, the horizontal or the vertical layout manager, putting stuff next to each other or putting stuff on top of each other. And as you can see here in the code, the way, if I do it programmatically, the way that I do it is that I create a widget that I want my other widgets to be child of. And then I create the other widget. So here I have the window, that's the topmost here. I create my push button called one. that this has the text one. I create my layout manager and I can call add widget one, add widget two, and so on. And at the end, window set layout, layout. And as we saw in the very second episode of this, I wouldn't do this myself. I would simply provide as a parameter to my layout manager here, the window. But that's basically the very simplest version of layout management. Then we have the grid layout, which is a one of the unsung heroes of layout management in Qt. It's rather powerful, actually. What you can do in here is that you create your grid layout as before, and this time you can see I actually specified the parent there. And this little trick on row two here, please get your pen and pencil and make a note of this, because that is a lifesaver if you do layout management by hand. Layout add widget one plus plus row. So now row is zero here and row stays zero. Then plus plus row down here. The trick here is that if you eventually come around and you want something on this row in between, then you just do that. Otherwise, if you had hard coded 001, then from one and on, you need to go and update all of them. It's not a big thing, but it's one of those best practices that is that's worthwhile. What it says down here especially is that there is no need to tell the layout manager upfront that I expect there to be eight rows and three columns. You'll simply just add them and it'll resize accordingly. And as you see here in this example here, it's also possible to span, as you can see over here on the screen, it's possible to span multiple rows on multiple columns. There is one more layout manager, and I actually burned my fingers on that not more than a month ago or something like that. This one is called Form Layout. And over the years, my understanding of Form Layout was that the idea of the Form Layout is that it depends on the operating system, whether it aligns on the right or on the left, I guess, or on the right. So the Form Layout, back up a bit. The Form Layout is a two-column layout where in one column you have the label and in the other column you have the input widget. So usually you would have line edits or something over here. So first name, last name, email address, whatever, and then a bunch of line edits here. But the trick or this thing that I did not realize, and when I prepared for this training, I realized it even by looking at the screenshot here, is that not only does it do the alignment, but also it on those operating systems that does this, so that's Linux and Windows, it will resize the widgets to the full column width. But on macOS, it actually will not resize. Notice how one and two here is smaller than three, which bit me because I had a layout that I created with a form layout on Linux, and it looked good. But those people using it on Macintosh was complaining that, hey, Jesper, why didn't you give us more input length for our line edits? Because the line edit would only get its size hint, which wasn't all that much. And I had way more screen real estate available that they could have gone. So these days, since a month, I've been actually myself going away from form layout for that particular reason. But now, you know, now you've been warned. In addition to these pre-built four layout managers, you can also create your own. You don't do that all that often, but there might be situations where you want something completely different. And let me just give you one example that I did once a long time ago. Do we have time for that? Yeah? Of course people wouldn't skip this part. Okay. So I was working with a customer and they had an application written in Motif, and they wanted it migrated to Qt, which is part of the service we do for our customers. So I looked at this application. I realized that they had created a separation where they had like 10 million lines of code that was completely UI agnostic. Well, it was a lot of UI in it, but it didn't talk a single thing about Motif. It talked about their own layer. So they created a layer where on top of it, there was no Motif. Then there was a very thin layer that implemented Motif. So they had their push button, their checkbox, and so on. And I thought it would be relatively simple to just go in there, take the push button and replace that with a Q push button, or implement it with a Q push button instead of a motif button. There was a bit of painting code that I needed to rewrite. But the hard part was that they had a layout manager. And that layout manager was, of course, the motif layout manager, which was called form layout, similar to the anchor layout in QML. Nothing to do with the form layout you just saw. But what they had was that their layout manager was just a very thin wrapper around this layout manager from motif. Therefore, what they did was that they just called into the layer underneath them, which called upon the motif layout manager. Now I had to take that layout manager and implement a motif form layout in Qt. So I subclassed from QLayout, and trust me, it took me months to get that bug level compatible with the motif one, because whatever corner case, whatever weirdness the motif layout manager had, I would bet you that in the thousands of dialogues I was using it above, there was one of those that was abusing that particular oddity. It is possible to create your own layout manager. We don't do that very often. And let that story, sorry for wasting your time on that, but let that be a story of being super careful when you try to layer your application, especially if you're looking into the future, saying, well, one day we'll not have Qt anymore, and then whatever replaces it will be using this. Just imagine if you were to implement the Qt's layout manager in something completely different 10 years from now. Almost impossible to guess what would be the right API. That's it for this episode. We only scratched the surface, and trust me, in the next episode, we'll go very deep in trying to understand what is a layout manager really, and how do you get it to look exactly like you want. Until next time, have a great time.